episode 3 of Storytelling, presented by the Dallas Swing Dance Society. I'm Ursula Hicks. Each month, we will bring you interviews with teachers, dancers, and musicians within the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex to provide a bigger picture of the swing dance culture we love. In this episode, I interview Ryan Martin, who fell in love with swing dancing during the revival in the mid-90s here in Dallas, Texas. Ryan recalls his journey in finding the Lindy Hop and gives us a better understanding of another swing dance favorite, the Collegiate Shag. Ryan has not only taught Collegiate Shag internationally, but has devoted time towards preserving the dance form through research and interviewing early dancers. This is his story. Ryan, thank you for joining us for this episode of Storytelling. How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you so much. So let's go ahead and get started. So let's start from the very beginning. Tell us a little bit about yourself, what you were doing before you found dancing.
Was I in school? I think I was in school, in college, like first year of college, something like that, or second, I can't remember, but I was mostly skateboarding. Like as far as like hobbies, you know, like I'm the type of person that tends to want to get into something, I go in it, you know, fully. And it was at the tail end of my skateboarding phase of my youth, I guess, in my early 20s. Yeah.
And, were you like Tony Hawk level or like?
No. It was pretty good though. I mean, yeah, good enough that I wish I had more footage of it.
When and how did you find dancing?
This is a question that like, I mean, I know how I found it, like in a sense, but like I wonder about this a lot because you know how when somebody tells you about something they're into, and you already have a sense of it and you wonder where you got that sense from of what it is, like origami or something, you know, just something like, because for some people swing dancing is just like a random thing, you know, like it's, they don't know much about it, but they have a sense of it. And I don't really know. I mean, I knew what it was, you know, from old movies and stuff. And I knew my grandparents did it, but I didn't really take interest in it until there was this, so there's this song. I realized this the other day, actually. I don't think of, yeah, this didn't occur to me until recently. A song played on the radio. And it was like I was really into punk rock and, you know, all this kind of angry music or whatever. But there was this, like, I don't know if you call it metal or hard rock. I don't know what you call it. But there's this song by this band that was here in town. And the song was called Infested. And it had this background track of Benny Goodman, sing, 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 playing with, and they're like screaming the lyrics and stuff, but it like somehow it worked. It was really weird. It was when sampling was becoming a thing, you know, like when the Beastie Boys were doing tons of sampling and all this stuff. And I just remembered that like song, just like the dancing, like struck a chord in me. And I remembered hearing those songs like on old cartoons when I was a kid and like old movies and stuff. And I knew my grandparents listened to it. And I was just like, you know, that's really cool. And so I went out and started digging up old music and asking my grandparents about and this kind of stuff. Next thing you know, I wanted to be like, I liked that look. And I wanted to, I don't know. I bought a pair of spectators. They were really expensive at the time because you couldn't find them anywhere. And And then me and a friend started, me and a female friend, we dated later. She'd come over to my apartment and we would imitate what we would see in old movie clips, whatever we could find, which wasn't very much. And Swing Kids, which is kind of pathetic because the dancing there is horrible. But we didn't know if there was no swing dance thing happening in Dallas. I mean, there was, but we didn't know about it. And there wasn't any Lindy Hop in it yet. And shortly after that, I went off to college and she called me up one day, was like, hey, I found the dance we've been looking for. Because I'm gonna back up a little bit. I found an ad for jitterbug classes and like, you know, like a local, you know, adult education catalog or whatever for like your rec center down the street or whatever. So, and I was like, oh shit, this is it. This is what we, you know, my grandmother would call it jitterbug all the time. And so I told Vanessa was her name. I said, hey, you know, we should go take this class. And we went and took it. And it's like, and I know that many people have had the same story, people who started back then in the 90s or whatever. It's like you go into the class and it's not, you know, it's not what you were looking for. It's like this ballroom studio-ified kind of dance. You know, it's East Coast swing is what we call it now. But, and I was like, and this, Lance Benishek said the same exact thing. He was like, I asked them, hey, I want to do what they did in the 30s. I said like the exact same thing to the instructor. And it's like, and he said the same thing that the guy said to Lance, like, no, this is what they did in the 30s and 40s. I'm like, okay. And I'm like, no, it's not. I mean, we know, we've seen the movies and stuff, you know? And anyway, so we imitated that. When I went off to college, when I came, my partner called me and said, I found it. And that was probably, Elaine was probably involved somehow, but I didn't know her yet. There were some folks in Dallas. I think Jay Rockwood was one of them, and Edward, I can't remember his last name, but they, a couple of them, maybe not Edward, went down to Houston, where Rowena and Woody had they had Frankie Manning Weekend. Yeah. And it wasn't called Lindy Fest at the time, but I think that was the precursor to Lindy Fest. And they brought Frankie Manning in, and those guys learned the Lindy Hop and went back to Dallas and were kind of just showing people on the side. I don't think there was any lessons or anything. And since I had already been swing dancing, you know, I drove all the way back up to Dallas, and, you know, Vanessa kind of introduced me to some people. And that was as far back as I know about it. But yeah, that was how I got into it. It was the music was why I got into it. I heard the music, I loved it. And then I wanted to move to it, and had this faint memory that I can't make sense of, you know, what swing dancing was.
I was about to say, with those movies where you guys, that you and Vanessa were watching, was it like on TV, like you were like TV guide on guys, remember when TV guides were like in the newspaper, like TV guide, yeah. And you're looking up like, oh, this looks like an old movie, maybe there's dancing, like how, right. Like how did that, or was it like old recordings that your grandparents or your family might have had of just like these movies? Because again, like the reality of pre-YouTube.
Yeah, I think I ran into some somehow. I don't remember how it was. Day at the Races was one of them. And I had not seen Hell's a Poppin' yet. And when I saw it, it absolutely blew my mind. You know, not only because the dancing was amazing, but because in the same film, you had two of the most influential sort of like groups or styles of the dance, like in the same film. That was just, wow. You know, like, anyway. I don't remember what else. It was something else really corny and didn't really have much to it. And we didn't know what it was they were doing. You know, nobody says, I don't remember anybody saying Lindy Hop in Day at the Races, but we would watch Swing Kids and rewind and fast forward on our VHS, VCR, and watch it over and over again. And you can't tell what they're doing because they're changing. They just give you like a little sliver of, you know, and they're doing an aerial called the waterfall, but you only see like pieces of it. So I don't know. There wasn't really anything worthwhile to take from Swing Kids anyway, except the Charleston and a couple of aerials. That was it.
Right. And just Christian Bale doing something.
Right.
Yeah. Moving on from that. So you found the dance, and you were saying, like, for example, in a sense, like you finally found the thing. So I guess, is that kind of like the revival? Or I know some people kind of talk about the timeline differently, like the resurgence versus the revival. So can you give us kind of your take on what that looked like what the revival looked like and things like that in Dallas specifically, because you were here.
Yeah, in Dallas specifically, I can definitely speak about that. In fact, in retrospect, I can say where I think we were compared to other cities too, because of speaking to friends and stuff over the years. But yeah, that was, I still have the receipt for that stupid jitterbug class that we took. And I think it was like, it was January, I think, or February. It was like early in the year, and it was like 1995 or 96, and I can't remember. And I think when I go back and look at it, I think it's 96. Yeah. But was for Dallas, that was super early on. There was no revival happening in Dallas that early. I know, I'm pretty sure, at least based on what Matt Jones and Austin told me, that Elaine and Mitch were doing it at that point. And they may have even been to Harang once at that point, but I didn't know them. You know, it was just sort of this weird thing where you two groups of people get the same idea at the same time, you know? And yeah. So, and then, yeah, Vanessa found this people doing Lindy Hop. I remember she even told me it's called the Lindy Hop because we didn't know what to call it. We didn't, you know, we just knew it was this sort of nebulous thing where they get far apart from each other and they're connected by one arm. And LA, it was way earlier. I think it must've been like 93, 94, 95, something like that. And most of the people that I talked to, they will say things like Jeremy and stuff, you know, 94, you know, they'll say things like that, which 95, some, you know, around that time period. And, yeah, I don't think that there was anything. The only thing I know of that might have been happening in Dallas that time, and I could be wrong, Elaine would know if anybody would know, is that Kim Lenz, like I told you, this is according to my friend Aaron Ballard, who was part of this whole crew that I was a part of at, you know, in 97, 98, 99. He said that Kim Lenz of Kim Lenz and the Jaguars was would teach people and taught him at Sons of Herman. On the dance floor, you know, just six count. It wasn't Lindy Hop, you know, it was just some sort of social dance of some kind, that was kind of swinging, you know, but that, I don't know what the connection is there between that and when Jay Rockwood and, what's that guy's name? Matthew Edwards. That was his name. Matthew Edwards and yeah. Elaine and Mitch and those guys, like, I don't know where the blend is, but it seemed to me that Aaron was saying that it was kind of like that was the first he remembered of there being any kind of dancing at Sons of Herman that was swing-like. And then after that, you know, Elaine and Mitch, I think, brought the real deal, you know, from Houston or from Sweden or wherever they, I'm not sure if they went to the Houston thing, but pretty sure Jay did. Anyway, some of these people are long gone. Aaron Ballard's in LA now, and Jay Rockwood, I have no idea where he is. Matthew Edwards is still around, but he didn't swing dance. Yeah. And luckily we still have Elaine.
Yeah. Cause I forgot about like Matthew Edwards' involvement with all of that. Cause he was actually somebody for everybody else who's viewed, maybe I should look him up because I bet he would have a lot of stuff. And he used to teach Austin with Dallas Swing Dance Society specifically, at least from what I remember coming up here in Dallas specifically. But during that revival, because I know, like, of course, I've talked to, like, in our past episodes, we were talking about, like, there being live music. With you being a younger kid at the time, were you guys able to go to those clubs? And did you ever dance to the live musicians here in town or things like that? What did that look like?
I was in my early 20s, and we certainly did. In fact, we were kind of spoiled because Vanessa and I unknowingly got into it shortly after Elaine and that gang. We didn't know what we were doing, but just the sheer fact that we had thought to do swing dancing and then this swing dance craze hit, which only lasted like 2 years max, you know, but with the neo swing bands and all this kind of stuff happening, it was like suddenly out of nowhere. And this is no good for a 20 something year old person or people to ever have this kind of thing happen to you. Cause you don't appreciate it, or you don't actually gain any depth in it. You think automatically that you're a hotshot because you know anything at all. I mean, I knew the Charleston and six count swing at first, you know, and like, I thought I was hot shit. And like, there's a few other people like me, but because we happened to think of it before other people in Dallas, when that craze hit, we were asked to like, hey, would you come to our club? Would you teach a lesson? So, yeah, I remember I took a semester off from college and I came back to Dallas and it was like, it was nonstop. It was just like, we were asked to do this thing, go to this like bar, you know, people would have, it's kind of like now how a lot of like, companies or people want to have a theme party, the Great Gatsby stuff, you know, it was kind of like that. And we get in for free everywhere and get free drinks and bands. Yes, there was several bands in Dallas that were really good. Mr. Pink was one of them, Cowboys and Indians. Nowadays, a lot of these guys these bands aren't even around anymore. The Flying Neutrinos, the Jive Bombers, they're from Austin, I think. Fly Neutrinos, I don't think, are from Dallas either, but I remember these bands existing. And then the ones that were from Dallas were Mr. Pink and Cowboys Indians. And then there was the Carrie something band. It was just like radio DJ, like guy, radio personality who played on a radio station that played jazz all the time. And he, Carrie Richards, that was his name. And he had a big band. And sometimes they'd play that sleepy, you know, music that nobody wants to hear in the swing dance community, you know, but sometimes they would play pretty good stuff. And yeah, it was, man, yeah, things were just going, you know, and it was just a blast. I mean, we were making money and, you know, it was cool because nobody knew what swing dancing was supposed to look like. So we would just go in there and do six count swing, you know, do it energetically with some aerials, and everybody thought you were the greatest, which is ridiculous, but it was a good time. And then it all just very quickly went downhill and disappeared.
So yeah, because that's interesting. I think, because that's the thing, it's just like the evolution of everything that was happening here, because it clearly didn't die. Because I mean, we wouldn't have like the well, again, I think I've said this in the other two videos still, is just like, for us to understand, like, Lindy Hop never died in general. It's just a sense of when we're saying like the resurgence or the revival, it's the popularity in pop culture. So that's something to keep in mind. But can you explain a little bit more, like, what was dead about kind of all of that?
Well, what I meant was the clubs and the money.
Okay,
and
yeah.
The flash, like it was just an inflated craze that didn't have any. It couldn't work because people were into it because of movies like Swingers. And a lot of people claim that they saw the Gap commercial and that's how they first found out about it, which is, you know, I mean, that was just a song and some dancing. It wasn't even really swing, you know, but
yeah,
kind of gives people this idea of this thing, you know, and yeah, all that stuff dried up. That's what I meant when I said kind of spoiled, you know. It was like, and Elaine remembers it. She'll tell you about it too. It was like, we danced at a Dallas Mavericks game, you know, on the sidelines, you know, like during the quarters or whatever. We didn't do the halftime show, but it was like the other breaks. And they had Mr. Pink playing on this, like, they created this, you know, like bandstand for them in the corner of the stadium. Yeah, it's nuts. I wish I had a recording of it. I have a recording of us horsing around in an empty, you know, in the empty Reunion Arena, but yeah.
Reunion Arena.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Reunion Arena. Yeah, it doesn't exist anymore.
yeah. That's awesome.
But yeah, all that. And now I feel like things are more mature. You know, the swing dance community in general is, it's more, has more substance. You know, it's not just based on this, hey, you know, because a lot of folks were just showing up to these bars, having a martini and trying to look cool and do this whole thing. But nobody except for us knew how to do the dance or cared. And it didn't really work, I think, for most folk to drink and dance. You know, they just didn't get that. It's like it had been so long since that had happened, you know, where it was like normal to drink and dance, like social dance, not just dance by yourself in a club, you know, but like do something coordinated with a partner. You know, I don't think people, it didn't work. It crazy.
That's what I've actually heard. Yeah. On the sidelines is like, that's the thing that's so interesting, that they would have these live bands and stuff at these bars, but the dancers weren't necessarily drinking because the coordination would be completely off. So I don't know how that helps with the bars at all, but.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We could dance. I mean, we could drink and dance, which we did, but if you have a culture or in a society or world where everyone already knows how to dance, right? They know something, you know, their parents taught them how to dance, you know, it's just a folk, you know, kind of culture thing. Then you don't have to worry about it. You can go have a drink. You already know some moves. It's no big deal. But to be completely new to it, to show up to the bar, have some drinks, then try to learn something, it just doesn't stick, you know?
Right.
And I mean, yeah, there was definitely that period where the dancers didn't drink. The whole groovy phase. And I mean, even during this, you know, the swing craze or whatever, which is, I guess, the tail end of the revival or whatever. There were a lot of dancers who didn't drink, but yeah, I don't think that that's what killed it.
Right.
I think
right.
Later it didn't give us a good reputation with the bars, but.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's enough about then. We're going to shift gears kind of completely and talk a little bit more about, I know you have passions about all the dances, but in my head, you're not only like the cool Ryan dude that I know, and philosopher cool kid, but you're also the Collegiate Shag guy, in a sense, you know, at least for us locally and even internationally. So I kind of want us to kind of move into kind of that aspect of the dance, because I mean, when we talk about swing dance or even vernacular dancing, like this still fits in that realm. And I know here in Dallas, like we're, not that we weren't aware of it before, because I remember learning about Collegiate Shag from Will Thornton. So shout out to Will Thornton, like, you know, going to Denton and things like that in college. But I think there's now been I don't want to say this and you can correct me, but like its own revival in a sense, like there's, at a bigger scope, there's like more of it happening now. First off, could you tell us a little bit more about what is actually Collegiate Shag? Where does it come from? Things like that.
Oh man. It's very complicated. I think Lindy Hop shares some of this complicatedness, because I'm pretty sure that the term Lindy Hop got attached to just whatever it is people in the Savoy or a Cotton Club or whatever are doing right now in the late 20s. And then later it really kind of became more of what it is. You know, it was still more like breakaway back in the 20s. So yeah, and that's confusing, because then you're like, well, is it breakaway and is it Lindy Hop and where's the line and all this kind of stuff? Well, it gets really complicated with Collegiate Shag as well. And part of what makes it so complicated, I think, is because I think a lot of times back in the day, they were vying for ownership of a dance, you know, whether it be an ethnicity or it be like a dance studio, you know, like somebody who owned a dance studio or was the head dance master. They used to have this thing called being a dance master or whatever. Then you want to sort of like lay claim to something and it become a big craze. And then, you know, your name gets more popular, et cetera, et cetera. And so a lot of that sort of, you know, corrupted the whole story. Collegiate Shag, the term collegiate, was something that was attached to a lot of dances back then, like before the swing era even. It was like, there was Collegiate Foxtrot, Collegiate Rumba, Collegiate whatever, you know, any sort of Collegiate Charleston. It was just a term that they attached to a particular dance that was already known to indicate the more energetic style that the college kids were doing, you know? And that's similar. I mean, that's sort of the spirit in which Shag took on that name, but originally didn't have that name, Collegiate Shag. The collegiate part wasn't on there. To make matters even more confusing, there was this like a fad or a craze of dances. You've heard of the animal dances, right?
Like, remind me, maybe.
Like the grizzly bear and the buzzard lope and all these things, of which the foxtrot is sometimes thought of part of that and sometimes not. I mean, it sounds like one of them, foxtrot, you know, but yeah, there was all these, the bunny, I don't think the bunny hop was part of either. That was like more like a thing out of the Charleston, but anyway, there was this phenomenon in the teens, I think, when these animal dances were created. And it was like, we tend to think of as a dance as like a fully fleshed out, you know, like basic, and then you've got maybe extensions of the basic, and then you've got moves that are added to that. And then you have certain movements or shapes that are sort of native to that dance, and then those that aren't maybe imported or whatever. This is the way we think about it. Back then, people, I think, more so would talk about a dance and a step and mean the same thing. You know, like, so, and I say this in part because just when I interviewed people, that's the way they talked about it. They would talk about Shag mostly like it was just a few things. It wasn't in the basic, they'd always go back to the basic. So these animal dances were like that. They were very simple. one or two bits to them. And Lindy Hop and Shag took a lot from that stuff. But after the animal dances, there was the collegiate fad dances, right? And this is like the varsity drag and a bunch of other ones that had weird names, most of which didn't even really exist. They were just things that were made up for a movie and they'd show it in the movie and whatever. But that's another thing that, you know, it's important not to confuse with collegiate shag. And there's, if you go back and look at the, you know, the footage or the articles and stuff like that, you'll see lots of mentions of collegiate all over the place. So if we strip the collegiate term away and all the associations that go with that, you just have shag. And that was the dance that existed before that term ever got attached to it. And before that, that same basic movement was called the flea hop. And it came from vaudeville, right? Because a flea hop was a move in tap, right? In vaudevillian tap or whatever. And it made its way into other stuff. I have a clip of, cha-cha, rumba or some tango, I can't remember, but it's like it made its way into a studio somewhere, and the flea hop is like, now it's a move done in that dance too. So
I just say, I know flea hop is like in some Latin ballroom stuff, like in
yes, Japan, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. It made its way from, you know, over many decades. Yeah, but so it was just a very simple movement, which is extremely similar to what we now call triple rhythm shag, which is a type of what we would call collegiate shag, a type of shag. So that was its origins. It was, I don't want to say undeniably, but we have very strong evidence to suggest that this dance first came about in the African-American community, the Black community, and then was later, of course, like usually happens, adopted by white culture. And, you know, and then it gets more into films and this kind of stuff, which makes it really tough because when we try and find those early origins of the dance and to see the aesthetics and the movement and stuff like that you were asking about earlier, it's difficult to find any film clips because a lot of times Blacks didn't get on film, and it's hard to find articles about it because Blacks didn't have as many newspapers as whites did. And, you know, they didn't, yeah, the whites had the power. So they ended up, you know, eventually, you know, appropriating it and taking over, and then you get film clips of it. But by that time, it's like maybe even a couple of generations away from its original look and feel. So I have clips of Blacks doing it, but not very many. And a lot of times it's after they're already in their careers and stuff, you know, like they're not doing it as a social dance anymore. They're just like there's one example, probably the best example is this guy named George Washington. I can't remember the follow's name. She's the singer and he's the trombonist, and they're in Louis Armstrong's band. Swinging on Nothing is the song. It's a soundie, right? And they get out and they dance like a basic or two of shag, and then they break off again and go back to doing what they're doing. That's probably something that George learned like when he was a teenager, you know, and he's just like doing it again, you know, during this thing. So they're like, yeah, hey, George dances, you know, get out there and dance or whatever. And yeah, so... anyway, it's like one of the few clips we have. So we have to like soak up every little bit of movement out of that just to try to recreate, you know, what the aesthetics of the dance was originally. That, and then of course, like people have interviewed people and, you know, we've got little bits of movement and stuff like that from that information, but it's, you know, the more generations, more people it goes through, the more watered down it gets. So it's very difficult.
Right. And I think what I'm hearing, and I think that's why I appreciate talking about dance with you, because I think there's like certain aspects that it's like things that I know, but it's just a reminder. And sorry, take it back, because I know you were saying like it kind of has a complex history, like Lindy Hop in ways is complex, but luckily we have like legends and stuff that are just reiterating a lot of the history. And I think that'll be another question too that I'll ask you in a moment, or just to kind of think about of like any living legends of collegiate shag that we could like kind of look out for. But I think that what you're kind of talking about and what I'm hearing is just kind of like how we put expectations on these dances versus understanding that it was an organic creation or an expression of what was happening or what the music is doing. And so in a sense, for me, as I'm learning more culturally about the dances, about vernacular dance, about swing dance, is that we have Lindy Hop, which is one expression of this music, but it's the same music in Collegiate Shag. This just happens to be a different expression of the same thing. And I think sometimes we try to categorize things so specifically, but we are not looking at either culturally or just like the environment of what those dances, like how they were created. It could be, it's just a matter of interpretation is what I'm finding. Go ahead.
Sorry. No, go ahead. Finish what you're saying.
Oh, I was just going to say, I think it's just a matter of like, at least for me, this is Ursula's personal opinion. Not that it's right or wrong. It's just an opinion. It's just like, it's sounding like as we're studying this stuff more, it's interpretations of the music or the interpretations, because it's based on our lived experiences and how we choose to move. And I don't think Collegiate Shag dancers of the time would have negated, not that anyone today does this, like negates Lindy Hop, but I think like in the sense of, again, culturally nowadays, we kind of categorize these things because it makes it easier, but to realize overall this stuff was happening at the same time. But yeah, I think that's what's so interesting. This just happens to be another expression, choice of the same music, of the same culture.
I think your Venn diagram thing might help us in this particular situation, because we've also got to remember that shag was earlier. It would, it it died out by the early 40s, whereas Lindy Hop was still kicking. You know, it was something that blacks would have been doing like in the early 30s. That probably would have been its heyday within the community within which it originated. It could have been earlier, actually. I'm not sure. But it didn't, you know, get on the screen and stuff, you know, until later. And even then, it wasn't, there was no champions doing it. We didn't have Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, which has happened with so many different dances, like the original Big Apple, not Frankie Manning's Big Apple, but the original one that was done in North and South Carolina. Yeah, that one, we don't have any footage. We have like a couple of pictures and that's it. You know, it's like, just really tough. But yeah, there are definitely choices, especially today. Like what you're saying, I feel like really applies to a lot to today. You know, it's like, these are choices because it is, I mean, you can draw the Venn diagram, you know, if you have the faster music, you know, like, or, you know, if you had like a spectrum like this, you know, and it's time periods, you know, going from like 20s to like 40s, or I guess for the camera, it's like this, like 20s to 40s. And then you've got like tempos, right, along the other, you know, like side or whatever, then you could triangulate or whatever the different places in there a given song could be, right? And, you know, it'd be like Lindy Hop would be a little bit later in that, you know, time period spectrum. Shag would be more back here. And I think Bow would probably be a little bit in the middle. So there is stuff that, like, you know, I would never want a Lindy Hop to like some of the really earlier stuff, you know, like Fats Waller. I mean, I know he had later stuff too, but like, I wouldn't, you typically want a Lindy Hop to that. It just wouldn't feel quite as good. So, but the section, these circles in the Venn diagram or whatever, there's like this huge chunk in the middle that's like every dance, you know, that like, it feels good to us to do, it's just swing music, you know? Mm-hmm. And so you're right. I mean, it is like it's a choice, you know, it's sort of like an aesthetic thing.
Yeah. Oh, Alex just asked, Ghost Alex here. And real quick, shout out to Alex, VP of currently of Dallas and Dance Society is online. He's never seen, but he's making sure that we sound okay. But he just sent in the question. Caller just sent in the question. How did you find Collegiate Shag though, Ryan?
So 99, Austin, Texas, they had a, me and Aaron Ballard, the person I mentioned earlier, and Vanessa Spazuco, my original partner, and a few other people from Dallas went down to Austin, and they had this thing called the Texas Swing Riot. And it was, you know, like just like the workshops we have nowadays, like several days on a weekend of dances and stuff. And there was, they brought in a couple who had learned the shag from somewhere. I'm not really sure where, but it was just the basic and like a turn. And they had a class on that and a class on the Balboa. And those were, they were like taster classes, you know, but it was, I wasn't really into the idea, but my friends kind of dragged me into it, you know, like, hey, there's these other dances. Let's go check them out. You know, there's swing dances. And I was so loyal to Lindy Hop. I didn't really want to have anything to do with it, you know, but once I got in there, you know, I thought it was pretty cool. You know, it's like, oh yeah, there's these other dances, and it was easier to do to faster music. So I felt like, well, this has its place, you know, and it makes sense. This must be what people did to the faster stuff, which, like we were saying earlier, it's not cut and dry. It's more, things blend more, you know. There is fast Lindy. You can do Balboa to slower songs or whatever. But yeah, I learned it there. Nobody would do it with me or Aaron or Vanessa. Nobody was, yeah, it was like you couldn't get people into it because they'd see Lindy and they just want to do Lindy. So years and years pass. I went off the army, and when I got out, I was looking to see what swing dancing, what had happened in the three, you know, or so years that I was gone. And yeah, I was specifically thinking in my mind, I remember thinking in the 90s, well, one of these days, shag and Balboa are going to get popular. You know, I mean, it's just what happens, you know. It's like eventually people get curious, you know, about the other, the sideline, you know, like interests or whatever, and they want to figure out what's going on with those. So shag had not taken off, but there was more footage of it, and YouTube had happened in the meantime. So I got really into Balboa, and then like a year later, got really into shag. And that was, and it's just me and some friends in Austin trying to make it happen, because we had, like, one of my friends at the time in Austin had seen it, not the same group, by the way, not Aaron and Vanessa and them, they had long since gone other ways. But yeah, me and my friends in Austin, we were, you know, it's like a four or five of us were trying to like make shag happen and Balboa happen, because it wasn't, didn't exist in Austin, not to any substantial extent. And some of us had seen it, you know, a dance, you know, like a dance event or whatever, somebody in the corner was doing it. And some of us had seen it on old clips, you know, or had, like me, learned it at a workshop somewhere in a taster class. We just, you know, we were kind of rebellious and didn't give a hurt what people thought. We just did it. Yeah. And so it became fun, because after a while doing the same thing all the time, you kind of bored and you want to explore other dimensions of the same, you know, sort of art sphere, you know, swing, you know, it's like a beautiful thing. All the swing dances are about improvisation. You know, all of them are about the music and these kinds of things. So it's like, the more of these you've got under your belt, the more songs you can dance to. And I think that was why I got interested in it. That was a lot of talking, sorry.
No, it's all good stuff. We love the talking. That's what this is for, to kind of give us all an insight of just like, from different perspectives, like different lenses about the same thing, but it all relates. Yeah. It's like different volumes. It's cool, because I think for you, so this leads into the question then, like, because I mean, I see you as a very influential collegiate shag influencer. That's such a millennial thing to say. So sorry to put it that way, but you do influence, and this is dance, because I think you, it is very trendy. I'm trying to be a better millennial. I'm such an old soul. But I think for you, like, what my impression of you is that you've also put so much work into researching the dance and stuff. So can you kind of, I mean, however long you want to, or briefly talk about, like, what have you found in these interviews? Like, how do you even start? Like, who did you find and stuff? Because I know you're, this has been like a forever project kind of for you, passion project, to kind of get more information.
That's a long story. Let's see how I can put it in a succinct manner. So, like I was saying earlier about skateboarding,
it's ironic enough. I was not expecting that. But, I was saying about skateboarding. Oh, cool.
Well, you know, when I get into something, I really get into it. You know, like I find something that I really love, and I get really into it. And shag is just one of those things. I mean, that's really the best way to summarize it. So I, you know, one thing leads to another. Like, I got really into shag, and like, I am the type who, when I believe in something and I realize it has value, like real value to it, I will persist. I'm very, I have a lot of perseverance in that sense. Like, I don't want to let people tell me I can't do it, or it's not, you know, like it's this or it's that, you know, and like it's dumb or it's the clown dance or whatever. I'll stick to it and keep with it, you know, if I really believe in it, even if people don't, you know, are into it. And there was some of that mixed with being sort of mentored by some folks like Peter Loggins. When I got back into swing after getting out of the Army, he was instrumental in giving me the resources I need to like study the history and stuff, which, you know, satisfied that like once I'm into something, I'm totally into it and I want to know more about it and absorb myself in it. And so he had an influence on me. And so I was digging through, you know, like some of his archives or whatever of conversations with various swing people and got information and found Shin and Bill Butler and went and interviewed them or talked to them or whatever. And then turned into interview later. And yeah.
Just, where were all these people? Because this would be local.
Yeah. They're Collegiate Shag legends, I should say. Shannon's grandmother was a shag dancer. Amongst her whole family are dancers. So they all know all these kind of crazy dances and stuff.
Would this be though California, like geographically?
They're from Minnesota.
Okay, cool.
But I mean, there's lots of people like this. You know, there's just these folks who like were really into it, like Lance Beneshek, the person I mentioned earlier. He was really into this stuff about the same time as Sylvia Sykes. You know, if you were nerdy enough and persistent enough, like I guess like me, you'd stick to these really kind of dorky things like, until you can kind of bring out the, you know, the cool side of them and show people what they can really, you know, provide us. This kind of thing.
With what we were talking about, and this is like your research and interviews and things, have you noticed, or what comparisons can you make aesthetically about the dance, either from the clips that you've seen and research to when you were learning the dance to now?
Like a comparison between aesthetically how the dance was to the best of our knowledge in the original era compared to today? Okay. So in order to answer that question, I feel like I need to like compare it to the other two principal swing dances. So Lindy Hop came first, right? And being revived. And like you said, it's not like it disappeared completely. It still existed in some places and it then gradually came back to where it was, you know, we can say that there is Lindy Hop in every major city in the world for the most part, you know. With Balboa that came a little bit later, and then Shag, it came even later than that. And I feel like Shag is still going through its revival in a sense. It's like it maybe toward the end, but Shag is right now where we were with Lindy Hop in like 2002 or something. At least that would be my rough estimate as far as like being revitalized. You know, because when we first started out in the 90s doing Lindy Hop, we were terrible. You know, we just didn't understand the movement and the feel of it and how to lead and follow the different bits and stuff. And as you learn those things and people get more attentive to it, and you have some people that have been doing it for a long time who aren't from the original swing era, then it starts to change and get more sophisticated. You know, not necessarily more sophisticated than it was in the original era, but it starts to take on a certain maturity in its second coming kind of a thing, you know, its second come around, that being the revival or whatever. So I feel like because Shag is still kind of getting there, you know, it's not anywhere near in that developmental process. It's not nearly as far ahead as Lindy Hop is. There, I definitely see big differences between how Collegiate Shag, was back in the day, as far as my best understanding, from where it is today. And a lot of that I think has to do with just the natural sort of phases that you got to go through to get a dance on its feet in this sense. You know, something that originated in the past, you know, and it's kind of like, is it going to make it or not? You know, like the hula hoop or the skateboard kind of a thing. You know, it's like, well, if they go through, I know it sounds funny, but if they go through several crazes, you know, like every 10 years or so it hits another peak, then you know it's probably going to stick around. Whereas, you know, like wall crawlers or whatever, those little like sticky octopus looking things, you probably don't know what I'm talking about.
I know, do.
Like, they came in the cereal, you know, you throw them on the wall and they like, but that died out, you know, like that kind of stuff. There's certain things that just don't make it, you know.
Sure.
With Collegiate Shag, I feel like it's still got a long way to go. I feel like the quality of movement and stuff is constantly improving, but In saying this, I'm kind of extrapolating. I'm thinking of the best dancers back in the day, you know, and I'm trying to sort of imagine what the best collegiate shag dancers would have looked like back then, just based on little snippets and stuff and like what you hear and like talking to Jean Foreman and seeing her as, you know, a tap dancer in Hollywood and then imagining her body movement and this kind of stuff, of which we have very little footage of her doing it and none of her doing shag. So she passed on some about the shag to me, but she could barely do it anymore. So it's, you know, it's really tough. But when I create that model in my mind of what, you know, that sort of peak sophistication of shag, you know, back in the day, I don't feel like we're quite there yet, you know? I don't feel like we've matched that. Whereas with Lindy Hop, I feel like you have come to that. You know what I mean? I remember Dawn Hampton saying at Lindy Fest or whatever, like, she's like, you guys are amazing. She's talking to the people who are performing and stuff. She's like, you guys are amazing. You can do things that we couldn't do. You know, it was like some sort of like, you know, like a threshold was reached, you know, and boom, suddenly Lindy Hop is maximally sophisticated, you know, or whatever. But I feel like shag is still trying to work its way there. And I feel like not enough of the lessons in the feel and the shapes and the form of the dance, the real spirit of just the movement itself has been fully explored. I feel like people think they are, you know, like they think that their shag is fully sophisticated and like maxed out. Somebody once said, it was Nick Williams actually, he said this, and I thought this is a really good line. He said, I'm gonna try to do it justice. And this speaks to what you were just saying. You want to, in order for a dance to be a living dance, you know, like you were saying, the living art form, you want to be able to contribute to it. You have to. It's not, you don't want it to just be a recreation of a dance. You want it to, you want to be able to understand the spirit of it, but also contribute a little bit of your own, of yourself and your movement to it without destroying what it is, you know? So it's like a healthy tension, like a balance, you know? And if you don't have the balance, then the dance spins off into something like West Coast and it becomes something completely different, you know, or contemporary ballet or something like that. It's no longer what it once was. It may be something, you know, there's this new thing, you know, but
it's branched off.
It's yeah, kind of branches off and then it's a completely different dance. But yeah. Leaving that aside, we're not even there yet. But I think that sometimes you've got to push things a little bit too far in order to realize that you've gone too far and it's not what it originally was anymore. With Lindy Hop, which is probably the best example because shag is going to be closest to that, or Balboa for like what's going to happen in the future, our ability to predict it. So Lindy Hop went through this groovy Lindy phase, you know, in like 2000, probably started around 2002 or so and extended until about 2007 or 8 or something like that. You know, like there being no sort of like hard and fast lines. That's what I was going to say earlier. Like none of this is completely discrete. They're not like distinct joints in which you can break things off such that they're nice little compartmentalized pieces. All of this is a sort of like a continuum or a flow of things. And you just have sorts of like quintessential examples of something like the music we were talking about earlier. It's like you've got a quintessential example of a song that people just feel like it's right for shag or it's right for Balboa or whatever. But it's not like there is this neatly sectioned off kind of music. Well, it's the same thing with, you know, the dance itself. You know, it's not that, you know, you have to follow, given there are dances that are like this, but it's not like with swing dancing, you have to follow these rules. Otherwise it's not, you know, shag anymore. You violated the rules, you know, the shag police are going to come get you or whatever. It's like, it's more nebulous than that, but people do have a sense of like, well, this is shag and this is not, such that if you push it too far, they get irritated and they start to like walk away from it, you know, whatever that thing is. And then people sort of, you know, learn, oh, I need to rail it in. This is not, you know, and the best example I can think of this is the whole groovy Lindy phase. It was like, Lindy was taking a lot of influence from blues and West Coast, you know, and there was a ton of that going on. It was the era in which people stopped dressing vintage nearly as much. And they, you know, everybody makes fun of it and says like, people wearing track pants and water bottles. You know, they were bringing their water bottle and their gym bag, and they wouldn't drink and all this kind of stuff. And it lost its sort of like that historical cultural aspect that you're talking about, how we're trying to bring that back into it. Is like it had lost a lot of that. And it was taking huge influences from other dances that weren't the same dance. And there's nothing wrong with that. But at a certain point, it just, I think people just were done. And they were like, that's not, I'm not into that anymore. And then it swung the opposite direction. And people got like super raw and like really, you know, hell's a poppin', you know, type stuff. So it's, yeah, it goes back and forth. And with Collegiate Shag, I feel like, we haven't quite got to the point where people are fed up with the explorations of mixing stuff. You know, it's like we're mixing stuff in there and we're trying all these things out because honestly, like a lot of people who are sort of like guiding the dance right now, currently exploring it, and are the teachers and stuff like that, they don't know yet, you know, what the dance is. It's like we're all kind of figuring it out as we're learning more about the history and as we're moving our bodies in certain ways. I mean, it all comes back to the basic in the end. The basic kind of decides, gives the form to the rest of the dance. And we'll be able to feel when that's gone too far. You know, we just haven't gotten there yet with Collegiate Shag.
Which leads me kind of to my last question for you. What are your hopes for the preservation and innovations of Collegiate Shag specifically?
I don't know. At this point, if you asked me that question like 8 years ago or whatever, I would have had very specific things to say. But I feel like at this particular point in time, I feel very comfortable with where Shag is. I feel like it's just headed down the same path, you know, that roughly speaking, you know, that Lindy and Balboa were, and I don't think it's going anywhere. You know, I think it's going to be around for, I think, you know, definitely beyond my lifetime, I'm sure. You know, I think it's here to stay, you know. It's just gonna have to go through those same phases or whatever in order to sort of establish itself, and for people to, for all of the leaders in the community and stuff, teachers and organizers and everything, to kind of get a deeper understanding of the dance itself. It just takes time. And like we were saying, it's got to experiment with other things, you know, including music. You know, like right now we're going through this phase where we're questioning whether or not it's okay, whether it makes sense to dance shag to rockabilly music and stuff, you know? So it's like music is another thing that can influence our dance. You know, it's like, I remember me and my partner used to go out and dance Collegiate Shag to hip hop, you know? And it was an interesting exploration for sure. But like, you know, like you were saying earlier, like hip hop dancing evolved from Charleston, right? It came down that path, you know? So it's like, and Collegiate Shag, it wasn't part of that. So it was interesting to mix that dance with that music, you know? And I mean, like you're saying with Lindy Hop, we do it, you know, we Lindy bomb, you know, like the club or whatever, and dance to music that you don't normally Lindy Hop to. And if you want, you can make it work with anything. You know, but that doesn't mean it feels quite right. And then after, and then you get over it, you know, you like try it out and you think it's kind of cool. And then you're like, okay, you know, like, let's go back to the music that kind of, you know, suits it more and whatever.
Even for me, when I go to dances, sometimes like choosing what songs I want to dance to, it's right. Like, does this feel right? Like there's something, yeah. Again, because of those expressions that were created for this music is, yeah. Why it felt right. You know, because it came, yeah. From expression.
Even if it's a new song,
copy and paste, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Even if it's a new song made by a current swing band, it still, mm-hmm. Has that same feel, you know, that you just want, yeah. To move like this, yeah.
Versus a copy paste, you know, type of thing, yeah. That we sometimes, yep. Do as we're exploring. But I think that's also part of exploration too. Is just for us, yeah. To sometimes that kind of happens.
Yeah.
Which ain't wrong.
But we've got to experiment and stuff. So, you know, it's like Shag's just the latest one to kind of go through that. So, and yeah, it's a continual thing. So I'm sure it will continue. But I like where Shag's going. I wish that we didn't have to deal with the politics. It's kind of ridiculous. It's just dancing, You know, it's like supposed to be a joyful thing. So why, you know, get all serious and mean with each other sometimes? But that happens, and it's just, you know, you just got to deal with it. So,
well, Ryan, I know that was a lot of information, and I know, at least in my opinion, that was like a wealth of stuff. So I'm just, it's always an honor to talk to you about these things and to geek out about the dance that we love. So thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us.
Well, thanks for having me.
Yeah. Take care.
Right on. Bye.
Bye.